Conversation of the afternoon is Luciano Castillo, and his topic is the energy corridor along the U.S.-Mexican border, changing the conversation.
Thank you, Cliff. It is indeed a great honor to be this afternoon here. I first would like to acknowledge my team, Wally Tiner, Rosalie Clawson, David Warsinger, Jay Gore, and Daphne Yogi. What we want to do here is to change the conversation. In the next 7 minutes or so, we hope to do that. When you look at this picture, you basically cannot ignore to see a lot of controversy around it from many points of view, including your political tension, including the fact that we have the longest shutdown in the US government as a consequence of this. You could also see the word mass migration, climate change, and there are many issues that could come to this, including human trafficking. But we want to change that negative rhetoric to something positive. We want to change from us versus them to all of us. In fact, Mexico is the third trading partner of US at $612 billion in 2017. And this is actually very close to Canada. So there are many, many reasons why we want to change the conversation here. First, this is what we're looking at. We want to convert the desert into a beautiful oasis. But what do I mean by that? We want to replace the rhetoric of a concrete, passive wall to something that will create the biggest innovation corridor ever built in the world. By doing what? Bringing energy, solar, wind, natural resources. We want to take advantage of the greatest resources in the region that exists here. And then we want to be able to create this oasis, but also enhance security. So basically, we're going to be creating opportunities in this region. A lot of the mass migration that is taking place because people are looking for what? Opportunities. And this is what we're going to be able to do here. This is what we're creating, the opportunity corridor. And I'm going to go briefly over this, but you could see there are big deposits of oil and petroleum in Texas. You have a big drought regions that exist, lack of water. So basically, by taking a lot of the water from the Pacific and the Brackets region, you could desalinate it, and you could bring water to the region. And then you have one of the biggest solar irradiation in the zone and best wind resources that exist in the United States. So we're going to leverage all of that to bring energy, water, by creating, and then we're going to create economic development in the region. Our team, let's look at this. What we have assembled is a diverse team with expertise in energy, water, agriculture, policy, and climate change. Collectively, we have created 12 startups, over 1,000 journal papers, 18 patents, 10 books, and combined index, age index of 170. We also have a combined work years over 50 years. So we have a diverse expertise. More importantly, since we start talking about this, even though we wrote this 2 years ago, since we started talking about this in February, we have seen 25 publications, one in Scientific American, two TV appearances, and President Daniels just wrote an article in Washington Post about this concept. What we're talking about here, friends, is about changing the conversation and making an impact at Purdue at a larger scale. We also have a consortium that includes Caltech, Stanford, and many other universities. How are we going to do this? Well, this is our approach. First, during the year one, we're going to integrate three basic new technologies that we have developed, including one that is a bio-inspired surface that allows to reduce the drag and improve the performance of wind turbines. Number two, we're going to include this. One of the major challenges in wind energy, the gearboxes break in many cases in 5 years. We're going to change that by bringing a hydraulic system from the top all the way to the ground and drive the direct reverse osmosis system. My colleague, David Warsinger, created a new patent that will allow us to do reverse osmosis with 30% less energy intensity. With all of these three technologies, we believe we could provide new technologies to the region. Number two, our expert, Wally Tiner, has great techno-economic analysis that we're going to bring to the table. It is very important that we show the possible economics businesses that this indeed is viable and that they could be making money out of this. And again, remember this, by integrating wind with natural gas, solar, and to do cost-effective the water, we could actually not only change the conversation, Think about the future with climate change. We will be solving a problem in the future by bringing water to the Southwest. Number three, we're going to provide a master plan that other economics, business people could bring to the region. Year two, and you see a prototype outside, we could reduce the cost of desalination by 30%. This wind turbine, the analysis we have done, we have shown we could reduce the cost of energy roughly by 24%. This is for offshore applications. And then we're going to deploy this prototype in different regions in the US border coast. In essence, this is what we do in France. We're using the unique resources from the region to create opportunities to reduce mass migration. We believe that Purdue, by deploying this project in that region, will not only help change the conversation between US and Mexico, this project could be deployed to other parts of the world. And this is, I'm going to shift this. Let me go to the last part because this is where the fun begins. All right. We're working right now with the Discovery Park to deploy a $100 million MacArthur Foundation proposal in August. Two, we're going to look at proposed funding from DOE and NSF. This in green because we're working right now on them. We're working with JCAN, with the private donors, to look for funding for this project. Number four, we want to present in Congress. We want to help change the conversation besides deploying this big idea and help change the language in US and Mexico. Number five, we have already a partnership with Maiva. This is an investment company in Mexico. So we believe that we're in a great position to make a big impact, not just for us, not only in the way research is done, because think about this. You're looking at this that we're gonna integrate energy, water, and food. This is a new science that we will develop as part of this project for what? Human crisis. And this is the rhetoric that we want to bring here. We want to change the language from concrete passive war to energy corridor opportunities. Now, why Purdue? Well, today I was just looking at, and yesterday, at some of the interviews that we're having. As Purdue, as a land-grant university, is to create a public impact. We already have a consortium of 32 people, including National Academy of Engineering, National Academy of Science. We're actually doing a What Is Festival in August, where we're gonna invite governors, Secretary of Energy, Secretary of State to come here at Purdue. We want to cement Purdue, and these are the words of President Daniels, as a world leader in humanitarian grant challenges. We're actually submitting a proposal to participate in the Paris Peace Forum. In essence, all of this visibility that we have received, including one in Scientific American, this is the article written by President Daniel, where he said, a genuine big idea. And I'm hoping, and we're hoping, that this could change not only the conversation, but that we could make an impact that Purdue, as a land-grant institution, will be a leader. Thank you so much.
So obviously this is a lovely message compared to the message that we've had. So there are two things here. You have a technology piece, but really this is a buy-in piece, right? I mean, it's a convincing people that this is an important thing, and wouldn't presenting to Congress and getting a MacArthur grant be really the first step to something like this, as opposed to the technology piece? Because you could deploy this given existing technology,
yes.
I imagine.
Natalie, this is a beautiful question. And actually, this is why we have one of the experts in our group, Rosie Clausen, an expert in policy.
I know her.
Yes. Yeah. And we want to be able to bring a new language, how the broader audience understand a major challenge and see, hey, we could apply engineering to a solution and do better than what we were. For example, let me add to the aspect of the economy, which I did not. By building an energy corridor, over time, because of the business that is gonna develop, the jobs, people could come to both sides, we could develop agriculture, over time, this project will pay off for itself. A wall, and these are part of the education that we hope to achieve. The technologies have to be in parallel. Part of that because you have to test new technologies that will make the water treatment cost effective from what we currently have. And by doing that, we could provide people an incentive. Hey, I'm going to set up my shop in the border because now I have an opportunity to hire people in the side of Mexico or inside of the United States and create a unique value that doesn't quite exist there, right? The transportation of vehicles could be a major benefit there as well. So I agree with you, we have to do that, but it has to be in multiple steps. And I think with the help we're receiving, we think we will get there. But and I think about this, right? It's a big idea, and we want Purdue to be at the big scale. No, we're not talking just United States, we're talking at the global level. And it's the problem of this magnitude that will help us reach that level of impact. But I hope I answered the question. Thank you, Natalie.
Yeah, so the chain of effects, the way I understand it, is technology, economic opportunities, stop migration, right? The way you presented it, right? So you want to seed some areas around the border with new technologies in energy production and agriculture that will create opportunities, right? Such as, the way I understand it, like jobs and business opportunities,
right,
that will attract the migrants, right? It's
very good.
No.
Is this
how it works?
Yes. Yes and no. Yes and no, right? But you're correct. So part of the phase one, sorry, Nan, I'm sorry that I'm too informal, but part of this is that the first aspect of this is that we need to have an economic analysis that makes this region economically viable for the companies across anywhere set up their shop there, right? At the same time, we are developing, this is the way we see the research, we see the value of proving technologies for industries to understand, look, we could integrate wind energy with a reverse osmosis system in a way that is economically viable. We could do things that, for example, mapping the area in ways that effectively tell me, I can put here the wind turbines, I can put solar PV, I can put here solar concentrated, even natural gas, in ways that leverage everything. But there's a certain order, right? And part of the economic, part of the ability to bring people, industries there, means proving to people through analysis, this is what WALI is doing, providing economic analysis, guys, this is viable. We could do agriculture here, and we could flourish this desert, this depressed area.
But again, if you go to the end of the chain, right, where you want to stop migration, what I see is actually more migration.
Yes. This is a good point. People want
to. It's not something that I agree or disagree with, but
no.
The stated goals, you know, I'm still trying to kind of figure out how this works.
Yes, beautiful point. And that makes sense. That's a fair question. What we believe is the following, right? People, most of the cases are moving to the United States because they're looking for opportunities. They're escaping violence, right? That, at least from that first order. One of the things we could do here, and you're correct, we create new incentive where people have new permit laws when they come and they go back and forth. You could imagine this technological corridor spanning over 2,000 miles. There's a lot of space where institutes, schools could be developed there. Yes, it will attract people at that point. However, at the lower end, in the southern border, you could create that and that mitigates the fluxes up there.
Yeah. Okay, so I just want real quick. So, on a follow up to that question, it sounds that your long term goal, you're going to be developing an enterprise zone. How are you thinking about that as urban development? So, what level of thinking? Because that 2,000 mile, 10 miles long border is going to be an enterprise zone that's going to require some sort of urban planning.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Tom. That's an excellent question. This is one of the reasons, and I didn't put it here, this to Congress. We want the Congress to appropriate $1.1 billion a year to institutes that we will run and lead in those regions. One of the reasons why that is needed is, as you pointed out, workforce development. So those institutes that will be located along different regions of the border, we allow for new training, we allow for language and adaptation, right? Part of the problem is that people cannot adapt to a new culture, so it's a culture shock. At the same time, with the policy, going to Natalie's question, new policies for migrating, for work permits, could be developed with social scientists. But you're right, we need that, and that's part of the proposal. And I apologize that it was not written there, but we're requesting that. Yes, Martin.
Does this proposal still include a barrier to control migration?
Beautiful. Thank you, Martin. And this is the quick question. Yes. And the reason is the following. I want to answer this in this way. You need to be able to protect the electric lines, the gas lines, the water lines. To confine them, you need some form of technological barrier for protection. But we're not creating us versus them. We want people to come and go and work and do agriculture on both sides. So it's a different perspective, but we're trying to provide things that people in one side concerned and the other side are concerned while prospering the region.
Have you and Wally and the others who are working on the economics come to a first approximation that this pays for itself, or is it going to require substantial U.S. and perhaps Mexican investment?
Martin, this is a beautiful question. One of the investment company, they have a house, they have an office in Mexico. We believe because Mexico is in the best interest to get the energy and the water, they will be a co-partner on this. And we believe that there's gonna be a partnership, right? Private sector, industry sectors, and foundations, right? So it's a mix of all of them, right? But the ballpark approximation, the cost that we saw, the two desalination plants with the solar panels, with the pipes for the transport of the water, that number came about 47 billion. Jay, is that the number that we saw once when we calculated about $47 billion? The solar panels.
Current discussions in the country about a wall,
yes,
is quite politicized.
Right.
And it seems to me very difficult for you with your idea to escape politics.
Oh, yes, so yes.
Do you have a political scientist on the team?
Thank you. Yes. Rosie Clawson is our expert on this.
Okay.
Yes, and she will help us with that aspect.
Is that Professor Porter?
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Martin.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.